Morning, Harvest. That is one heavy pulpit. That's all I got to say. Well, it's good to be with you. Hey, do you remember when the Olympics used to be a thing? Do you guys remember that? Like, I remember as a kid, I remember as an adult, I remember like turning on the Olympics and it was like, man, I can't wait to watch these events. One of my favorite events to watch beside the hockey, that's the Winter Olympics, but in the Summer Olympics was track and field because the announcers, they would show so many different things going on. They would show the field and they would show a race and all of this was kind of a distraction or something that was leading up to some of the finals. And in the finals, it was fun to watch the guys do the hurdles. I have no idea how they jumped over those things. Like, no chance. The 4x100-man relay as they passed the baton, and who is going to be the fastest person in the world? You guys remember that? Anybody or just me? Okay, it's just me and a couple others. But the really cool thing about those Olympic days and watching this take place was the 4x100 relay. Because they had this little thing that they would pass. And what's this thing called? A baton. And you would think, this is like, how simple is it to pass a baton? You'd literally just, you get out and you pass it and the other person takes it. And yet it's so much more complicated than that. It's, they actually plan out and work on how can we pass this baton without missing a stride, without missing a beat, without doing anything that would cause us to take our eyes off the finish line. And the athletes practice this, and they're allotted a certain space before the baton is handed, and then that person backs down, the baton is handed, and that person takes off, and they go to the next place with the baton, and they're trying to figure out inside that space when is the best time and how is the right speed, and they practice that more than any part of the race. It's important for those runners to run as hard as they can, but man, if you mess up that pass, it's a big deal. You get disqualified, or you don't finish. And this last year, America was predicted to do pretty well. And once again, we think the easiest parts of the race, just passing the baton. You can find it on YouTube. The baton was passed, and it was like touching up here and there, and they couldn't get the pass right. He looks back. He finally grabs it, and they didn't even qualify for the finals. Today, we're finishing our series on Elijah. Elijah has the blessing, the opportunity to take the baton that the Lord has entrusted with him, to be the prophet, the spokesperson for God for so many years, and he's going to pass it off to Elisha. And just like we need to be intentional in a race and passing the baton and moving forward with what we have an opportunity to be baton takers or baton passers. All of us here today are in a race. And we have this baton either coming to us or we're giving it to somebody else. We're going to see Elijah is going to pass it off to Elisha. And before we get into 2 Kings 2, I'd love for you to flip back a couple pages because 1 Kings 19 kind of tells us a little bit about we haven't seen Elisha. And all of a sudden, at the end of the message last week, we got to a place where it says the call of Elisha. So 1 Kings 19 says, starting at verse 19, it says, "So he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with the 12th." So this is like a big place. 12 yoke of oxen, this is not a poor place. There's a lot going on here, and there's these guys going out there in the field, and it says, "Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak on him. And he left the oxen, and he ran after Elijah and said, 'Let me kiss my father and my mother, and I will follow you.' And he said to him, 'Go back, for what have I done to you?' And he returned to following him, and the yoke of oxen, and sacrificed them, and boiled the flesh and the yokes of oxen, and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and went after Elijah and assisted him." Did you catch the handoff? Elijah took the cloak off of his back, saw Elisha, and put it on him. That's the transferring of the baton. Can you imagine Elisha on that day? He knows who Elijah is. It's no surprise to him. I'm sure he's heard the stories that we've gone through in this life of Elijah, where he did all these things as unto the Lord. And now this cloak is being passed to him. He knows the handoff is happening. It's been put on his back, and he's got the baton. And today we're going to see what he does with that baton and how he handles the transfer. So whether you are a mentee grabbing this or the mentor passing it, there's some things that we should pick up on, and one of them is how Elijah finishes well. Faithful to the end. That's what Elijah was. He was faithful to the end. And that's what we're going to be looking at today. Would you pray with me? Dear Father in heaven, as I look out in this room today, as we have the opportunity to hear from your word, I'm thankful that each one of us have an opportunity to either take the baton or to pass the baton. And I pray that you would just help us to see our way through this passage today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Howard Hendricks, a very famous professor at Dallas Theological Seminary, said, hey, this is not a new concept. Moses passed it on to Joshua. Elijah passes it on to Elisha. Paul passes the baton on to Timothy. Good, so you're all still awake. That's great. And Howard Hendricks said, you know, much like that's happened throughout scriptures, we need to have some people around us. We need to have someone who is more mature in the faith. Didn't necessarily say older in age, mature in the faith, because we all come to Christ at different stages of our life. So we need to have someone who's more mature in our faith, who is like wanting to help us and to see what we can't see and to help us so when that baton gets exchanged, we're ready to go with it. And we need to have someone who's in our life that we're passing the baton to. So someone who's more mature and someone who is not as mature. But don't look down upon that person. Look at that person in such a way that they can't help but see Jesus and want the baton to be passed to them. I think about Elisha, and on this day, the cloak being passed onto him. The excitement that must be there, but then also the responsibility of grabbing that baton and running with it. And many of you have had that experience in your life as well. Well, there's three things I want us to understand today about this whole experience of whether you're a mentor or a mentee. We're both in that if we have someone who's more mature in the faith with us and someone who's less mature in the faith and we're trying to pass on. Elijah's passing it to Elisha. There's some key truths to finishing well. The first one, I'd love for you to write this down. A person who finishes well is steadfastly resolved. He is steadfastly resolved. Take a look at 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 1 says this. Now the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, and Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. So the first place I really want us to take a look at today, there's four landmark places where God showed the Israelites who he was in a powerful way. And I think as you are a mentor passing the baton to a mentee, you're looking for ways to be able to speak into the person's life so that you can speak and they can hear. And a mentee is trying to listen to the words so that they can receive those words and they can ask questions about how they can do this as well or better or faster than what you did. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to pass it on so that it goes from one generation to the next, and we get the privilege today of watching how this takes place. So here's Elijah now and Elisha. Some events have passed, and they're standing in the city of Gilgal. They're standing in the city of Gilgal. What's so important about Gilgal? Well, that's the place when Moses was making the transfer to Joshua. It's one of the first landmarks that's taken place as Joshua crosses the Jordan River. Do you remember that? Joshua crosses the Jordan River, and what does he plant? He plants some stones of remembrance by the Jordan River, by Gilgal. So you can imagine that as Elijah and Elisha are at Gilgal, the stories that are being talked about, the transfer of Moses to Joshua and at Gilgal and the significance of that town. Everyone's got a story, right? Everyone's got a beginning. Egypt was Israel's past. They walk into the promised land, the stones of remembrance. It's a new day. Hopefully everyone's got a story of a new day, of when you asked Jesus to be your Savior, something new, a promise that you haven't received before. And when you receive a promise that you haven't received before, it's brand new to you. And I'm sure that he spent a little bit of time on that day talking about when you receive the promise, when you receive the inheritance, when you receive the gift of salvation, it is yours. But don't look back on the past. What I want us to remember about Gilgal is this. Gilgal is a landmark of historic beginnings for Israel, but it's also leaving your past. You think about this mentor who's passing the baton on to the mentee. Your new faith in Christ, or your continued faith in Christ. Remember, if you don't pass the baton right, it's you can look back, and that can be something that can happen to each one of us. And that Gilgal is a reminder of the new beginnings of Israel in the promised land. But it's also a reminder for us not to look back at our past. Don't let our past define who we are. And don't let our past distract us from what's ahead. Israel did look back, right? They're like, when they were getting to the promised land, man, the same bread and the same provision. And it would be better for us to go back to Egypt. Really? To go back to slavery, to go back to bondage, to go back to? When we look back, it's a distorted view often. And so Gilgal is a place where I am sure Elijah was trying to pass on some principles to Elijah. New beginnings, fresh start, new life, stones of remembrance. And don't look back. Just press forward. You know, Paul mentioned that in Philippians 3. Forgetting the things which are behind, I press forward to the things that are ahead. How important is it when the baton is being passed or you're receiving? We can't glory in yesteryear. How many times have we gone out with people that we've grown up with and we can spend so much of our conversation talking about the past and not talking about the present, or it might be the potential future in the days ahead? May we be people, whether we're mentors or mentees, that are looking for ways to share about God's faithfulness, God's goodness, as we're passing the baton from one generation to the next. Elijah, first place, Gilgal. Now they're going to travel 8 miles. This is a little journey where they're traveling along the way, and they go from Gilgal, the landmark of historic beginnings, and forgetting the past, to now they're going to the second town, and it's called Bethel. And Bethel is a landmark of the house of God. So they're walking together for 8 miles, and this is a place where he reminds them of God changes things. Let's take a look at this. So they, verse 2, and Elijah says to Elisha, hey, please stay here at Gilgal, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel. But Elisha said, as the Lord lives and as you yourself, I will not leave you. So they went down to Bethel. And the prophets who were in Bethel came to Elisha, and he said to him, don't you know that today the Lord is going to take your master from you? And he said, yes, I know it. Be quiet. Why does he say stuff like that? Well, you can imagine this trip, walking and talking, listening and learning, talking about Gilgal leading up to Bethel, the house of the Lord, where God changes things. It's a meeting place. And they're on this journey. They show up at Bethel. I can't imagine some of the stories that he talks about at Bethel. Maybe he goes back and he starts talking about Genesis 12. In Genesis 12, where Abraham is promised future generations, and then he left a pillar outside of Bethel. Maybe it's Genesis 28, where Jacob has this dream, and there's this ladder of ascending and descending, and he plants a stone of remembrance at Bethel. Or maybe it's where Jacob wrestled with God and God changed his name from Jacob to Israel. Forget your past name and forget the behavior that you were. I'm changing you and your character today. Bethel, a place where God does an incredible change. We've got that in our church. We get to see changed lives on a regular basis. The privilege that I've had for many years is to be able to see what God has done at Camp Harvest. Has anybody here ever been to Camp Harvest? Men, women, boys, and girls? Yeah, that's a place where we get to see God change things. It's going to a place, asking the Lord to meet us. And Bethel was that place where the Lord just met. It was the house of God. And as people come to Camp Harvest, there's a sensitivity, there's an alertness, there's an eagerness to receive. And maybe you're the mentor. How's it going with your eagerness? And as a mentee, how is it going with your being eager to receive, ready to listen to a word from the Lord? It's so great to watch this baton being passed in the race. People are running with intentionality. People are running with drive and determination to pass the baton. And the one who receives it is ready to hear. And on this day, they're in Bethel, and they're talking about the ways that God has shown up in their lives. For some, it's at Camp Harvest. For some, it's here right in this room. For some, it's you're sitting in your room at home, and you open up the Word of God, and you're feeling the presence of the Lord of comfort or peace or strength or security, and you're wanting the Lord to speak into you. A place, the Bethel, is an amazing place. It's a landmark, a house of God where change happens. Bethel, it's a place that reminds us that we need to be fully dependent upon the Lord. We need to be a people that surrender to the Lord. We need to be a people who sacrifice for the Lord. Maybe Elijah even shared some of the stories with Elisha. Remember? I prayed for no rain, and it happened. I prayed for a resurrection to take place that I've never seen happen before over this child that died, the widow's child, and it happened. It's a place where it's special. It's a place where God shows up. He's trying to prepare Elisha with these amazing stories of where he's seeing God at work. That's what a mentor gets to do. He gets to display the glory of God in ways that it's tangible expressions of faith being lived out. How do we finish well? We finish well by just being so consumed and so convicted by the Lord and so called by the Lord and so determined to pass on those good words. Well, they go from Bethel. Oh, I didn't tell you. So these prophets that are there, and he says, be quiet. It's kind of like a weird thing, right? Hey, be still, be quiet. These prophets, it's kind of like when they're going from town to town, there's these schools that are being trained up as prophets, but they're prophets not in the place where Elisha's going to be. Elisha's the one who the baton's being passed to. And they are looking at like, Elisha, don't you know? And he's like, yeah, I know. I need to listen. I need to be intent on what Elijah's passing on to me. And this happens 3 times. And I think there's something really important for us to hear in this. There's going to be a lot of voices that try to distract us or try to get us off track or try to help us just focus on the event that's going on versus what's happening here. Is God is trying to communicate to Elijah, and Elijah is trying to communicate to Elisha so that this pass is transferred in a way that brings God the most glory, and the prophet who's going to be empowered doesn't need to be distracted at all. All of us, we all get a chance to receive that baton at some time, right? And this is one of those amazing transfers that's going on. Well, they leave Bethel, the landmark of the house of God, and they go to look at the next section. Verse 4, Elijah said to him, Elisha, please stay here. The Lord is sending me to Jericho. So now they're going to hike about 12 miles to Jericho, and Elijah tells Elisha, hey, stay here. It's a second time. Why does he tell him to stay here? Well, back in 19, remember when he gave him the baton, when he put the cloak on his back? That's a symbol of being devoted and committed and called. And Elijah's saying, with that, there's responsibility. And Elisha's like, I'm here for you. Because every time Elijah says that, look what Elisha says. I will not leave you. What a joy it is as someone who gets the baton to say, I'm going to take this and I'm going to run with this. I'm not going to leave the Lord. I take this serious. I'm going to be committed. I'm going to be dedicated. That's what we get to do today. We get to watch this taking place. What an exciting event that's going on. In verse 4, Jericho. They show up there. It's a landmark of a battleground. Jericho, the landmark of a battleground. It's where walls come down. Elijah is deliberate in the choices that he's making and the places that he's taking him to. Elisha quiets the prophets in this town. He responds to them a little differently, silencing the noise. Jericho, it's the place where enemies are defeated. Jericho is a reminder that God does the fighting for us. It's not what we do on our own. Jericho is a place that we call out to the Lord and he shows up. Jericho is a reminder that it's not about our strength, but it's about a dependence upon the Lord. Jericho is a place where a battle took place, and maybe he doesn't just spend his time talking about the walls of Jericho coming down. Maybe he tells him a little bit of what's going on in his life. Remember Ahab and Jezebel and them being called down? The Lord took them. They're no longer in power. Maybe it's when he stood before the prophets of Baal and he's like, remember that day when we said, pour more water on, do all these things that it could only be putting God on display, and then a fire consumed the altar. Elijah, trying to pass these truths on to Elisha, let the battle be the Lord's. Our strength, our flesh, we are not in this battle. It's a battle that belongs to the Lord. Remember what God did at the city of Jericho. Jericho is a battleground where the walls come down. What's your battleground today? Maybe your battleground is a physical battle. You're like, man, I don't know what to do with this. Call upon the Lord. Ask him to show up in a mighty way. Maybe it's an emotional battleground where it's over fear and anxiety and trust. It's a spiritual battleground. I don't know what your battleground is. We each have our battlegrounds. And how is it that in the battle, we just like totally depend upon the Lord? Jericho. Verse 5, the sons and the prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and they said to him, do you know that today we will take your master away? And he answered, yes, I know, keep quiet. And Elijah said to him, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan. To the Jordan. It's a landmark that shows that God provides. This is his final trip. The tour is coming to an end. But Elisha, don't miss this before the transfer is fully yours. Because I'm getting taken to heaven in a whirlwind. I know that doesn't make sense, but today's my day. Don't miss this. These final places. Can you imagine that? Thinking about the Jordan and all the significance that's taken place. The Jordan being parted before, and here the cloak is taken and it's thrown down on the river, and the river parts. And don't miss the phrase that says, and they walked to the other side. Here the mentor and the mentee, they're walking together. The cloak is thrown down. God shows up and divides the Jordan. They walk across to the other side. It's both of them watching God do an amazing work that only God can do. The Jordan, it's a place, it's a landmark. The Lord provides a way. Can you imagine the 50 prophets who are standing there and they're watching all of this and the cloak gets thrown down and the river divides? I bet you their jaws drop to the ground like, oh, look at that. Look at this amazing God. He's showing up again. How is God showing up in your life as a mentor? How is God showing up in my life as a mentee? It's so important that in this transition, that it's all about what the Lord is doing and showing people that. Well, our second point today, faithfulness to the end, requires us to be spiritually hungry. Faithfulness to the end requires us to be spiritually hungry. Elijah never lost his passion. Elijah never lost his hunger for the Word of God. He never lost his hunger for following passionately after the Lord. Elijah was doing this to the end. And he's saying, Elisha, in order for this to happen, you have to have this passion in your life. I feel so privileged to be able to think about the past that I've had. There was a guy in college who took me under his wing. He had a really cool name. He was Dr. Smith. But Dr. Smith was one of those, and in his class, he's like, I want to spend some time with a couple of you young men and pour into you. And the only reason why we all said yes, it was we couldn't help but want to be around him because he had a compelling walk with God. He was spiritually hungry. Every time he opened the word, you were drawn in. For those of us as disciples, all of us in this room, what is our hunger level for the spiritual? Where are we at in our walk with God? So Dr. Smith, and then when I went to Trinity, Warren Benson, Dr. Benson, what a privilege it was to be able to spend some time with him and travel with him and to see his heart and his hunger for the Lord. Now I'm in a different stage. I was the young buck then. Now I'm the old guy on the team. And as I look at the time at Harvest and the opportunity that the Lord has given to me, I want to be a guy who finishes well. I want us to be a people that finish well. I want us to be a people who are thinking about where I'm at. I can't wait to pass this baton. And we're looking around. What a privilege to think about Pastor Brian and to think about his time here and what is it that draws him? How can he continue to grow in his spiritual hunger? May I be someone in his life that the Lord could possibly use to be able to influence him because of the love of the Lord. It's something I learned. It's something that I received. I was given the baton. Get a chance to pass the baton. I think about Pastor Ramirez and Pastor Larry, and there's so many that the Lord has brought up on the team. The baton passing doesn't just have to be to one. It could be to many. So how are you receiving? How are you giving? Spiritual hunger should be a part of all of our hearts and lives. Hungering for the Word of God, thirsting for the Word of God, craving closeness with God, spiritually hungry. Look at verses 8 through 12. Then Elijah, he's at this Jordan, but he said, as the Lord lives and as yourself live, I will not leave you. So the two of them went on. 50 of the sons of the prophets went and stood some distance before them, and both were standing at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, he rolled it up, he struck the water. The two of them could go over onto dry ground. And when they crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, what shall I do for you before I am taken away? And Elisha said, please, let there be a double portion of your spirit on me. It's a pretty big ask, and look at what he says. And he said, you have asked for a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be for you. Faithfulness to the end requires spiritual hunger. The two of them just cross, and Elijah asks Elisha, what is it? Is there something that you would ask of me before I go to the heavens? And he said, I would love a double portion of your spirit. Why is it such a hard thing? Because he asks something that Elijah can't give to him. It's something that only the Lord can give, and only the Lord is going to be the one who makes it available to Elisha. How is Elisha going to know if he's going to get it? If the visual of Elijah departing, if he can see it. There's a condition to it. If you can see it, you'll get it. And that's the confirmation of the cloak being put on you, being able to see, and the double portion being given. And that double portion is an Old Testament, back from the book of Deuteronomy. The double portion being given to the oldest son But that's not about the financial resources. It's not passing on a financial legacy. This is passing on a spiritual legacy. And he's asking for a double portion. It's not out of arrogance. That's not out of a pride. It's like, all these places that you've taken me and you've told me the stories of God and what you've seen God do, how can I not want more of that? More of God, more of his presence in my life. Do you crave that? Do I crave that? Would we ask for the double portion? Or if Elijah were to ask us, hey, what would you want today? Is the first thing that crossed our mind, I'd love some security. I'd love some financial independence. I'd love physical health to be much better than what it is. Those are common things, and they're not bad things. But Elisha on that day says, I want a double portion of the Spirit of God. Oh, church, I'm begging of us to have hearts like that, because that's how God works. God works through us today. Each one of us have this baton. We have each other, and we have others that we should be pouring into. There's a community that needs to know that Jesus is alive in the midst of challenge. They need to know about how you've seen in a battleground, the walls come down and your God shows up. They need to know of all these landmark places, like Israel had landmark places that pointed to God. They need to hear our story of God at work and the baton being passed, and they get to observe your life in great ways. So these are the things that are important for us today. More of the Lord. Nothing else will satisfy. Elijah's life is compelling. Any other request pales in comparison. I just want more of the Lord. I hope we can get there. I hope that we can grow in that desire and that hunger. Then look at verse 10 and 11. And they still went and talked. Behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elisha went up in a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw and he cried out, my father, the chariots of Israel and the horsemen. And he saw him no more. Out of nowhere. He knew that it was the day, but out of nowhere, Elijah is taken. We don't know the end of our day, but we do know that what we can be like until we have that end day. And Elijah departs, and he sees it. And it's a confirmation that it, that double portion, is coming your way. That means that you are the one who has the baton officially handed. You know, how many of us want to take that baton before it's the right time? Elisha could have been like, hey, man, I know this is your last day. I'm just going to take that baton now, and I'm going to run with it. Thanks for everything that you've done. I'm going to move forward. He could have done that, but it wasn't his time. Elijah could have been like, you know, I could take you to all these places, but you'll have to figure it out. Why don't you just figure it out on your own? No. The baton, it's such a delicate, intricate, but so important to invest in and to think about the deliberateness of the baton being passed. And the Lord knows the right time, and he took Elijah up in a whirlwind. Can't imagine what that would be like. But now Elisha has got the baton. I'd like for us to think about this as our third point. Faithfulness to the end requires us to be securely confident in the Lord. Faithfulness to the end requires us to be securely confident in the Lord. Not in yourself, but in the Lord. Look at verse 13. And he took up the cloak of Elijah that had fallen on him, and he went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. And when he took the cloak of Elijah that had fallen on him, he struck the water, saying, where is the God of Elijah? And when he struck the water parted to the one side and to the other, and Elisha went over. Don't miss that. The thing that came down from the heavens, Elijah's cloak, he puts it on. And what does he do? He takes it over to the Jordan. Where is this God of Elijah? And he takes it, and he throws it, and he strikes the water, and the waters part, and he walks through. such a dependence upon the Lord. He knows it's his time. He knows it's his place. Can you imagine those prophets that are watching all of this? Whoa, it really happened. Elijah did that, and God showed up, and he walked. Elisha now does that, and he throws down the cloak, and he walks through. It's all of our time to be like that. It's all of our time to watch the Lord working, and he takes it, and he walks to the other side. So those of us who have received the baton, every one of us, are walking in such a way that when people are watching, they're observing our dependence upon the Lord. It's not what Elisha did. It's what God did when Elisha was obedient with what was given to him. How will we be different today? How will we walk out of here as a people that are like all about pointing people to Jesus? More of the Lord, less of us. His first steps as a leader were all in for the Lord. His first steps of the mantle being passed and Elijah is no longer in the race and he's running forward, his steps are to the Lord and his faith is growing. He's securely confident in the Lord. Hey, that's not easy. Remember, the baton passing is difficult. But what we do at those first steps of showing our dependency upon the Lord is crucial. Multiple people are in a relay race, right? There's four. And as I look around this room here, there's multiple people. Who is in front of you? Can you come up with a name? Who's in front of you that you're going to pass it off to? And who's that Paul in your life? Who's the one that's run before you? The one who is more mature, speaking into your life that you can constantly see the passing and the receiving of the baton. I like to have visuals, and so this one is in my office, and it just simply has the word advance on it. I've had it in there for over a year. Who is it that we can pass the baton to advance the work of the Lord, faithful to the end? It requires us to be steadily resolved, spiritually hungry, and securely confident in the Lord. So may the Lord use his word to challenge our hearts on this day. Let me pray for us. Dear Father in heaven, so thankful for your word and for the challenge it brings. Each one of us in this room, so blessed to have seen you work in our lives, different places, different landmarks of where you've shown up and you've shown yourself strong and faithful and true. And Father, I think about the chance, the opportunity we have, each one of us here, to be a mentor and a mentee with a baton in our hand at all times until you take us home. Help us to be faithful to the end. Help us to be a people that are passionately pursuing you. Help us to be a people that are just spiritually hungry for more of you. Lord, find us to be faithful. Find us to be humble. Find us to be committed. And help us to do this handoff well. Use us, Father, this week, even as we minister in our community, even as we minister to one another. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray.